5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Ignition, liftoff.
Artemis 1 will lift off from Launch Pad 39B at NASA's Kennedy Space Center in Florida with 8.8 million pounds of thrust provided by the most powerful rocket in the world, our Space Launch System rocket, or SLS. The uncrewed flight will be the first integrated test of SLS, our new Orion spacecraft and exploration ground systems at Kennedy. Artemis 1 will send Orion beyond the moon, 280,000 miles from Earth, farther than any human spacecraft has ever flown.
This is not NASA doing this. This is the United States of America doing this program, the Artemis program. And there are companies all across our country that have a part in it. So there is kind of this wave of excitement being generated just by saying, we're going back to the moon.
After the upper stage of the rocket separates from Orion, the upper stage will deploy small satellites over several days to perform science experiments and technology demonstrations. Orion will make its multi-day outbound trip to the moon, propelled by a service module provided by the European Space Agency. Engineers will test Orion's systems on the way to the moon. Then, Orion will fly about 60 miles above the lunar surface, using the moon's gravity and engines on the service module to enter a lunar orbit. After about a month and a total distance of over 1 million miles, Orion will return home, faster and hotter than any spacecraft has before. A primary goal of Artemis 1, ensure Orion safely returns to Earth before we fly with humans. When we do, we'll build our capability for sustainable lunar exploration, preparing us for missions farther into the solar system.
Initially, what we'd like to do is start establishing a presence on the moon. So we're going to establish going back there on a regular basis, and then we'll end up setting up Gateway, and we would launch to the Gateway, and from Gateway, land on the surface of the moon.
We are there for, you know, weeks, months on end. And there, we're going to be able to test out all the hardware and the habitats and the hatches and the suits and the rovers that'll allow us to prove out those technologies. The moon will lead the way to Mars, and we should be there within the next couple decades.
Today on 321 Liftoff, you probably our most exciting podcast since we began podcasting some 88 weeks ago. Every week, we've been going on location to tell you about the most fantastic attractions, restaurants, museums, and cultural aspects of what Florida's fabulous Space Coast has to offer. Today, we pull back the curtains to tell you what the Space Coast is really all about. Today, we take you behind the scenes and share with you the highlights of the Artemis program, NASA's newest program to return astronauts to the moon by 2024. But even more exciting is that this program plans to land the first woman and the first person of color on the moon using innovative technologies to explore more of the lunar surface than ever before. Our guest will be Ashley Nelsen with NASA's Exploration Ground Systems at Kennedy Space Center, where they develop and operate the systems and facilities necessary to process and launch rockets and spacecrafts during assembly, transport, and launch. So pull up a chair, as we'll be talking with Ashley and learning a whole lot more about the Artemis program, coming up next on 321 Liftoff. And now we go.
50 years ago, we went to the moon. We called it Apollo.
What many people don't know is that Apollo had a twin.
She was a woman named Artemis,
goddess of the moon.
We are returning to the moon
as a new generation of explorers,
this time to stay.
And to prepare to achieve humanity's next giant leap of sending the first human missions to Mars.
We believe our course will redefine what is possible.
That we would discover life-saving,
earth-changing science.
And that the challenges ahead will inspire generations.
This is our manifest.
For all who wondered if we could return,
for all who dreamed of pressing beyond.
This is your calling.
We go for all of America.
We go. We go as the Artemis generation.
We go
3, 2, 1. Liftoff. We have a liftoff.
Welcome to 321 Liftoff. I'm Wayne Belden, the president of Belden Communications, the publisher of the Space Coast Fun Guide and spacecoastfunguide.com. We'll be bringing you 321 Liftoff each week, talking about tourism on Florida's fabulous Space Coast. With me is the host of 321 Liftoff, Bonnie King, former deputy director of the Space Coast Office of Tourism, as well as the past president of the Florida Film Commission. Bonnie, are we ready to blast off on 321 Liftoff?
Hey!
You guys are so exciting, I'll tell you.
Friday!
Hey, welcome to another insight to beautiful Florida Space Coast, a vacation destination that offers 72 miles of space on our beaches, the only beach that doubles as a launch pad. And in addition, did you know that numerous celebrities have called the Space Coast home, and one of those homes was where Jim Morrison of The Doors fame lived when he was a baby. The home has been an attraction for many people who come into the area and just like to go by and see, oh, that's where Jim Morrison lived as a child. It's a two-bedroom, two-bath home. It's a 1935 vintage home, but it's now up for sale. So if you're a Jim Morrison Doors fan, $2.5
million. That's it?
$2.5 million.
So I'll pick it up on my way home.
No, I'll tell you what, if you want to own a piece of this iconic rock and roll history, it is available now. And if you're interested, just get hold of us at info@spacecoastfunguide.com, and we'll put you in touch with the realtor so that you can do that.
That's right.
Hey, and talking about history, it's been over 50 years since humans walked on the moon, and now NASA has the Artemis Project, whose mission aims to land the first woman and the first person of color on the moon. And I think in 2024, they might have to extend it to 2025. You know how it is with all that going on. But our guest today is Ashley Nelsen, and she's with NASA's Exploration Ground System. So we're going to be meeting with her and talking with her. 321 Liftoff is brought to you in part by the Beachside Hotel and Suites, which is where we are today.
Beautiful
background.
Live,
that you
right
see
next
here
to the pool. It's 82 degrees.
Absolutely. It's a gorgeous day outside. And Michelle Martindale is going to join us so that she can tell us a little bit about what's happening here at the Beachside Hotel and Suites. Also, Longboard's restaurant and tiki bar, which is located just down the street at the Hilton Oceanfront. And it has a fabulous ambiance for food and drink. And of course, by the spacecoastfunguide.com, where you will learn what there is to see and do in this fabulous area that we call the Space Coast. And joining us today is a man with his own history. Yes, with his own history.
My own
John
history.
Belden, Vice President of Belden Communications. Hey there.
That can get dangerous.
I know.
What history I want you to know today is up to me, right? So happy Friday to everybody. We're here at the Beachside Hotel and Suites, beautiful pool. And this is going to be a very exciting podcast, as my father hinted earlier already. That there's actually so much new technology that offers advances into the exploration of space. I mean, can you imagine reaching the moon today with all the innovative technologies that were not available back in the 60s and 70s before I was born? So many changes, so many new opportunities. I mean, it's awesome. And I think that this will make great conversation, because not only humans in space have the power to stir our souls, but the people working on this to make this happen inspire us to reach for the best within us all.
Oh, I mean, nicely said.
I'm kind of a poet. You didn't know it, did
you? Yeah, I know. I love it.
Joining us today is our producer, Phil Bird. How you doing there, Mr. Phil?
This is my favorite part of the week. I love coming here. There's literally a beach behind Bonnie.
Right.
I don't know if you guys saw that while watching
yes.
that, but there's literally a beach right there.
Yes. Yes, yes.
I love it here.
And, of course, the president of Belden Communications, my father, Wayne Belden. How you doing there, Pop?
Son, I got to tell you, I take a lot of pride sitting here and wishing you your happy birthday. I remember bringing you home in a little blankie.
That's
I remember
right.
giving
it's
you your,
your
first
it's,
bottle.
It's
I remember
birthday
doing
week.
All that stuff, and now you're 39, sitting next to me doing a podcast.
And I still
that's
won't
phenomenal.
Shut up.
Yeah, yeah.
Thank you, Dad.
Yeah.
That's
I appreciate
right.
that.
It's your birthday week.
There have been times I did want to send you into space, though.
Yeah.
I will tell you that. And the ultimate purpose of going into space is to live and work there. It's human destiny to explore, and many of our young people are already positioning themselves to be astronauts for the next phase of space exploration. And all that is happening right now, here on Florida's Space Coast, working with NASA to establish a sustainable presence on the moon to prepare for missions to Mars is our guest today, Ashley Nelsen. Ashley, welcome to 321 Liftoff. We're thrilled to have you.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Absolutely.
So a lot of people are going to say, wow, Ashley with NASA. Ashley, what do you do? What is your role? Tell us about that.
Thank you. So I'm in Exploration Ground Systems. That's here at Kennedy Space Center. We're the grounds team that are going to launch Artemis I. So everyone's very familiar with the VAB building, you know, the launch pads, you know, that ground infrastructure. So the Exploration Ground Systems program at KSC, we've modernized, we've updated all of our infrastructure, and we will be the ones to launch this this upcoming.
That's got to be a heck of a feeling to know that you're such a part of such an important program like that.
Yeah, yeah. So I'm in strategic communications. So why I'm here talking about this and sharing it with you all. So we want to make sure the public knows that the Artemis generation that we are all a part of knows what is coming up of this exciting launch.
I have to ask this question, and sometimes it's embarrassing because people are shy to talk about themselves, but this is a very prestigious job that you have. How did you...
You're like
24. Did you go to school? Did you go to school for something like this?
Or? It's a great story. How do you get there?
Sure. So I started... I went to UCF. I'm local.
Charge on Knights.
The Knights.
Yes. Born in, you know, right here across the bridge and grew up in Titusville.
Nice.
So grew up, went to UCF. I majored in business, finance and business management, was working on an MBA there, and came across a NASA internship. I had never really considered it, but growing up here, it sounded awesome. Obviously, yeah. I was familiar with watching launches, you know, from
Space
my backyard.
Coast, NASA, yeah.
You know, born and bred into the launching kind of atmosphere. So did an internship. They have an amazing internship program, NASA Pathways. And it is a great way for students to get not only experience, but get your foot in the door out with NASA. A lot of people, you know, sometimes they're saying, you know, oh, I just graduated. How do I get a job out there? And you actually want to get a job out there before you even graduate. So the NASA Pathways program is how I started, you know, 10 years ago, started as an intern, finished school, graduated, had a couple different positions that have led me to my position today. I was, in procurement, contracting officer for the government, and then went to the launch services program in program planning, which the launch services program launches from KSC. Those are the unmanned science and robotic missions, so like your Mars rovers, cool. The planetary missions. Yeah, so I got to experience some of the unmanned side, and they're actually launching soon. GOES-T is the next launch for LSP. It's a weather satellite. So, you know, the technology that we are launching affects all of us daily, you know, and helps.
So that we can try to get these weathermen more on spot with the weather?
Yes.
Oh, it's not to control the weather?
No. Although my wife and I, we joke because, you know, whenever there's a storm here in Florida, for some reason, when it gets near Kennedy, it bounces away real quick. And she says, I know they've got some, like, gadgets over there in the warehouse that they're keeping secret because you always push that storm away. Or,
tell us, Ashley.
The scoop.
I don't know the real scientific reason, but if you look at the map, there's the little hook where we stick out, and I swear, just storms, hurricanes, they want to just bounce off of us.
You got something.
I think we were strategically placed. Somebody knew something a long time ago.
Smart engineers, right?
Right.
So we can't, I mean, maybe it was a weatherman who said that, so, you know, we got to be careful with our people.
Jim, what's his face that comes down here all the time?
Yeah, you know. So it's interesting that you started as an intern doing probably a little bit of everything in each department or whatever, and then did at some point this job opportunity came, or did they say, we want to move you into this position? How did that work?
So it was an interesting transition. I was working for the center director, Mr. Bob Cabana. He's now the NASA Associate Administrator. So he has moved up from the center director of KSC, and he is now, you know, the highest civil servant in NASA.
Nice.
So I was working for him, and the position opened up, and I was like, you know, I really think that's my passion. I really think, you know, communications and working with, you know, the public, stakeholders, we engage with, you know, children, STEM engagement. I was like, I think I really like this, but I don't really have much experience with it. And he's like, kind of gave me that extra nudge to throw myself, you know, into the fire. And I applied and, you know, found a new passion that I didn't really know existed. So kind of fell, you know, it kind of.
It's great.
You have a level of confidence about you, though, because, you know, it's not easy to speak in public settings with large groups. And I've been to events that you've been the guest speaker. And
you do a great job.
You do a fantastic job.
I'm going to say it. Swag.
Swag.
You've got swag.
It's that swagger.
Swag.
Thank you very much.
Well, I thought swag was stuff that you give away.
Well, that too. It just depends on what part of town.
I guess how you use it, right? Yeah. Well, here we are sitting with NASA. Everybody knows the name NASA, but let's also discuss the power of women. I mean, look at how many women have come forward and have been elevated through the NASA program, and you're a perfect example of that. But there's so many. You are an inspiration to many young women, young ladies out there that are saying, I would like to explore space. I would like to see where I fit in. And it's nice to know that NASA has that NASA pathway, and maybe people that have their own businesses might look at this as an opportunity for them to have their own pathway for their own organization, that the people might be interested in whatever it is that they're doing. So I think that you're right. Paving the way for a lot of people. Absolutely.
Thank you.
Yeah,
I have to throw kind of on that. Our launch director, Charlie Blackwell Thompson, she is the first female launch director, I think, in the world. So she will be the one to give the go and lead our launch team for this launch.
How exciting.
That's another great opportunity. Maybe we ought to have her at some point to do the same thing.
Is this her voice?
That's great.
Is this her voice?
3, 2, 1, 0.
Is that her voice?
So I don't know if that one was, but she is in the video. There is a clip of her. She's got like reddish hair.
Okay.
She is so well respected, an amazing leader, and she will lead our team.
See, I love that. I've got a 12-year-old, soon to be 13-year-old next week. Lord help me, 13-year-old daughter, and I love seeing things like this because it's unlimited your potential. You can do anything. That's incredible.
And you're leading the charge. Isn't that great? We love that. Love that. So let's talk about some of the things that we did see on that video and the two videos that were shown. Is there something that you'd like to explain about what it offered? Yeah.
Yeah. So Artemis I is the first integrated flight test for Orion and SLS. Exploration Ground Systems, EGS, will be launching it, but this is a nationwide effort. We have suppliers all over the country, over 3,000 suppliers. Our SLS program is based out of Huntsville, Alabama at Marshall Space Flight Center. And then the Orion program, our spacecraft that's going to hold our astronauts, is based out of Johnson Space Flight Center in Houston. So while Kennedy, obviously we're all around the launch and the big show,
right.
But this is really a nationwide effort that is coming together. So Artemis I will be the first integrated flight test that is unmanned. It will go out and around the moon and then come back. And then Artemis II will be our first manned mission. And then Artemis III will be boots on the moon. And then there's a whole cadence for these launches to continue.
It's well said.
It's time, just like they said on Super Bowl Sunday. It's time for Space Coast Trivia, where we get to test the knowledge of everyone on today's podcast about random facts that we should know and where the only prize is bragging rights. Space Coast Trivia is brought to you by Longboard's Tiki Beach Grill, located in beautiful Cocoa Beach, next to the Cocoa Beach Hilton. Learn more at longboardstiki.com.
Go to Longboard's Tiki Beach Grill and enjoy a casual, laid-back atmosphere under their covered tiki bar with direct ocean access on their pool deck. Enjoy refreshing frozen drinks, enticing lunch specials, and a diverse menu of appetizers and entrees. Yep. We eat there all the time. We love their food, don't we?
Yep.
So open till midnight, weather permitting. They actually have kids' menus available, so make sure to take the kiddos with you. And don't forget to join them for seasonal live entertainment on the weekends. Everybody's always asking me because they know every week we promote this. All right, John, what's playing this weekend? So Friday from 6 to 9 is Island Breeze for those reggae lovers. From Saturday from 6 to 9, I know Jonathan Honeycutt, Bonnie likes, he's actually the drummer for Hot Pink.
Yeah.
So awesome. You want to go see him?
And you know I'm a Hot Pink fan.
I know. You're a big fan of that band. Everybody is, actually. Yeah. If you haven't seen Hot Pink play, you need to go hear them. And then Sunday from 1 to 4, we got the 506 crew. Again, another reggae band. So the feeling is going to be right there at Longboard's Tiki Beach Grill. All of this and more at beautiful Cocoa Beach at Longboard's Tiki Beach Grill. So, Phil, what do you have for us today, my friend?
Take a wild guess.
I think it has to be.
Does it have anything to do with space?
Space and NASA. So I thought about, I was like, this should be everybody versus Ashley, but.
You're right.
Yeah.
So we have a chance.
I have it as girl power versus boy power here.
Okay.
Uh-oh.
No pressure.
All right. So all of these questions are multiple choice. So just you guys confer what answer you want, and then you guys confer what answer you guys want.
Okay.
Are you ready, teams?
Educational.
Team 3, 2, 1, you ready?
You ready?
All right.
Ready.
Team girl power, you ready?
NASA girl power.
Okay. All right. First question. In what year was NASA established in the United States? Is it 1949, 1959, or 1969?
Say it.
B.
That's what I was thinking. Okay. 59.
It's 1959 because 57 was when Sputnik went up.
Correct. All right.
Yay, 59. Very
We're
good.
We're so smart.
Yeah.
All right. Question number two. The space station orbit approximately blank miles above the Earth. Okay. Is it 225, 250, or 300?
Is it 250?
Say it again. What was the question?
How many miles is the space station away?
I'm thinking 250.
Is it 225, 250, or 300?
I'm going 300.
I'm going to want 300.
300? All right.
We'll go 250.
Girl power with the 250.
Oh,
250. Because the.
It's my birthday. Yeah, I get it fast.
Yeah.
Go to your room.
I should have given him a point for his birthday.
Right.
Yay.
Do I get to phone a friend next time?
Right. All right. Question number three. Which was the first artificial satellite in the world that was launched by the Soviets just 1 year before NASA?
Sputnik.
Sure.
And you'd already said it before, so we all knew that. Yeah.
All right, question.
This is a tight game here.
Number four.
Yeah. All right.
Name NASA's Mars exploration rover mission. Is it called the Curiosity rover, Sojourner rover, or the Spirit rover?
Curiosity.
Curiosity.
Well, I'm not going to argue with NASA's.
Yeah.
Curiosity.
We obviously, it's Curiosity, of course.
I had it written down for the record.
Okay, I just wanted to say anything. All right.
So is this the breaker?
Whoa. They are ahead.
We're ahead.
You're ahead? Oh, yeah. That's right.
So one more question, and if we're
I'm going to give, since it's John's birthday, this question will be worth 2 points, okay?
For me only,
okay.
It's 2 points extra.
2 points. All right. How many space stations are there in the world? Is it one, two, or three?
Technically two. There's the U.S., and there's a Chinese.
But wait. Okay.
International Space Station.
I was going to say, she said technically, and I know she's right. I'm not going to argue, but maybe he got it wrong.
Maybe it's a trick question.
Okay, no. Let me. Okay. Can I clarify something? Did you say how many international space stations, or did you say how many space stations?
How many space stations are there in the world?
Okay, so
two.
I'm going two.
All right. Well, I answered ahead of us.
It is two. So the winner of the game here is Girl.
Congratulations.
Yeah. Thank you very much.
There was a lot of pressure there.
There was,
like,
right?
I had to perform. I'm like, if I don't know these answers.
You know, it's so funny because everybody that comes on here and we try to, I mean, our producer, we don't know what the questions are going to be, obviously, because Phil does it. But we always know, okay, he's going to ask about something that you have something to do with. So, you know, you try to do a little research, but Phil does a good job.
He does.
But he's not paying attention to us right now. Yeah.
I'm sorry.
John distracted him. Sorry.
I was looking at all the girl power messages. They called you bossy. You're not like bad bossy, but like good.
Like
bossy.
A boss.
Oh,
like a
that's
boss.
Good.
Yeah.
Nice. Thank you.
That's good.
My paperwork.
Oh.
I think the wind took my read. That's all right. No worries.
Okay, so.
I have an extra one.
Go ahead.
So which one are we on? Oh, we did the trivia. I'm sorry. Yeah, I'm getting a little lost in space, so I've got it.
Space cadet.
Point. Yeah, so was there anything else about those videos that we were discussing that before we got into this that you wanted to mention? Because I know those, and by the way, those were great videos put together. The video pictures themselves and the photographs are just amazing. You guys do a great job.
Thank you.
Your photo library at NASA and the video library of NASA is amazing. And a lot of that is free to the public, isn't it?
Yes, yeah. There are a ton of great resources out there. You know, check out the NASA websites, the Artemis websites. There's an Artemis blog where we post regular updates about our progress, you know, what's up next, these milestones. But, you know, just in general, I just wanted to highlight this story. It kind of goes back to the girl power, which wasn't my whole theme of today. But
right.
If you heard in the video that Artemis is the twin sister of Apollo.
I know.
So it's a really neat story. And the why behind, you know, the Artemis program, and we're going to have a sustainable presence on the moon. So it's a long term, you know, this isn't just a one launch, it's a long term presence on the moon. So we can learn how to live and work there and eventually go on to Mars and become a multiplanetary species.
Yeah. And she's goddess of the moon. So we're going to be hearing about that when it's happening. So that's going to be very cool. When is the first one supposed to go? Is there a date?
So right now we are preparing. Teams with EGS are doing some testing. We're going to prepare to roll out of the VAB building for the very first time with the Artemis 1 rocket on top of the ML and the crawler. We're going to roll out to the pad for the wet dress rehearsal. targeting mid-March right now. It'll be out there for about 2 weeks. The wet dress rehearsal is a 48-hour test. It's a full tanking test, so we'll go through the whole simulation like we're going to launch, with the exception of launching. And then we'll roll back to the VAB, do some final tests and checkout, and then we'll be preparing to launch. Right now we're targeting launch windows in April and May, so it's right here.
Around the corner.
Now, when they do that, will the astronauts actually be on board?
Not
the first one. We do have some passengers on board. So Snoopy, if you watch the Macy's Thanksgiving Day Parade, Snoopy was in there and his astronaut.
Right. They talked about it.
They made the announcement that Snoopy will be the zero-G indicator on Artemis 1. So he has a custom flight suit.
Very good.
Yeah, wow. He's currently at KSC, like under lock and key. Once SLS rolls back in Orion, he will be installed back in the VAB after wet dress rehearsal. And then we have some other passengers. There is a male-bodied torso. His name is Commander Munikin Campos. He was named after Arturo Campos, who was integral in bringing the Apollo 13 back home. So we had a vote from the public of a series of names, like bracket style. So Arturo Campos is who he was named after. And that's in the front seat. In the back seat, we have two female-bodied mannequins called Helga and Zohar. And
oh, my gosh.
Where do they come up with these names?
So they were named by some of our international partners, the Israel Space Agency and DLR, Germany's agency. So it's an international effort, and all three of the torsos and mannequins, they'll be collecting data, so we can understand what the astronauts will feel and the radiation and vibration. So we're collecting all this information for this first integrated test flight for when we have our astronauts on Artemis 2.
All right, I got a tough question for you.
Wow, that's going to be interesting.
How much? Come on. How much to do it? I want to do it. How much do you need? I see SpaceX is doing it. How much you guys need? How much I need? I got $25 in my wallet.
$25.
Right now.
I'll throw it another 25. We'll make it 50.
All you have to do is just move one of the mannequins to the side. Like, I got a seat for field.
Sneak in.
That's it. How much?
NASA has a great open call for astronauts. They collect diverse people with crazy different backgrounds. They look for, it's not just your standard, you have to be an engineer or a scientist. They want, they want that diversity.
Do they need a podcast?
Yeah. From space.
You never know. We have to share.
We can make it work.
Yes.
We do have to share the story and bring the public along with us. So there may be a need.
Yeah. And sharing the story, when I'm on your website, if you go to Artemis Program, if you just Google Artemis Program, it'll come up, and it has a map of where everybody is working to make all of this happen. It is amazing how much across the United States that the people are involved in this. And I just say United States. I didn't even include, international. But, just for us to know that, not that you have to live here in Florida to be part of it, though we'd love for you to be part of it here in Florida, but there's so many activities that are going on all over the United States. And if you look at that map, it's very inspiring is the word that I want to use, because it's really, really good. So go to your website. Now, your website is it Artemis.com? I don't know what it was. I just Googled Artemis.
Yeah, program. I mean, you can Google NASA Artemis. We're on social media. There's Artemis accounts, Exploration Ground Systems, if you want more of that local feel and that launching aspect. But the Artemis in general, I mean, Facebook,
it was a great website,
Twitter.
Because it really does tell you everything that you need to know. And they actually have the whole Artemis plan. Mm-hmm. You download it and it gives you everything from start to finish as to what it's about. So it's really exciting. Now, I want to go back to Phil, because when Phil was talking about being an astronaut, mm-hmm. And she was just saying, as Leslie was just saying, it's not like it used to be, like back in the day when you had to be a certain type, not only physically, but mentally and educationally whatever.
As long as
so
mentally.
So you're saying there's a chance.
That's right. So you're saying there's a chance.
All right.
I thought I said that in a nice way, didn't I?
Doesn't matter how smart you are, Phil. You have a chance, buddy.
That's right.
You and I both were eligible this time.
All right.
The cool thing that we haven't touched on with this launch, and you mentioned it at one of the meetings that we were at, as far as the pounds of thrust, right? So the Delta Heavy, if I'm not mistaken, I think was around 500,000 pounds, I think was the number, somewhere around there. Because this one's, 800,000, right?
I think so.
Yeah. So the Delta Heavy, let me tell you, when that thing went off, if you haven't listened, for all our listeners all over the world, when you come to the Space Coast, you definitely want to, there's launches all the time. I hope you get to experience one. When the Delta Heavy went off, it actually shook the light bulbs and my fan so much, it broke one of the bulbs.
Wow.
And that was at 500,000 pounds. Wow. This one here at 800,000, I believe is the number you said at the last meeting, this is going, you're going to feel it in your bones.
Yeah, this will be a launch you do not want to miss. And you will see it from miles. So anywhere on the beautiful Space Coast is a great view. Like, it is... It's going to be big. This is the most powerful rocket in the world.
I know, and that is exciting. I mean, I remember, and Michelle, I'm sure you're going to remember too, when the Heavy went off, the amount of people that came in
ahead
of time.
Yeah, we're going to have a lot of people here.
I mean, so early, and I think it was an afternoon launch, but about like 4 in the morning, the bridge was packed.
Right.
All the roads were packed. The people that came internationally for this was incredible. Yeah. So I think we're all very, very excited for that.
And just to say that Michelle Martindale has joined us now at the table. She is the sales director right here at this beautiful property that we're at, the Beachside Hotel.
Thank you, Bonnie.
But we just want to know that you're here just to offer your
Hi, Michelle. Offer some little insight
because really think about it. When that does happen, we're going to have people coming in from all over because they want to feel. We always talk about that feeling you get when it goes up.
Yep.
And, you know, people want to feel it. They want to be part of that. So,
I haven't experienced that yet, and I want to so bad.
I need to. Come stay
here
at Beachside Hotel and Suites, and when the launch goes off,
Ashley, can I, maybe I'm asking a question I shouldn't be asking at this point, but do they know who the very first woman is that's going to go up?
So they have not, so we have a class of Artemis astronauts, but they have not announced the specific astronauts for Artemis II. So we do have a class that are learning, training. They'll be at a lot of these milestones, but we have not announced specifically.
Do you know how many women are in that program?
And
the only reason I ask, because remember when we started with the 7 astronauts, remember how competitive they were? Because they didn't know who was going to be the lead, who was going to be the person that was going to land, you know, that was going to get to go. It's just so interesting because I can imagine those women, I mean...
Can you imagine
being competitive and going, I want to be that
woman. Can you imagine that first woman?
Yeah.
Can you imagine the amount of pressure... That's gonna every little girl in the world is gonna look at that at her.
Woman, yeah,
every person in the world is gonna look at her, and it's going to leap, the feminine mystique forever.
Yeah.
It's going to put you in the forefront of what your capabilities are. You're not gonna be able to anymore say a woman can't do this, and a woman can't do that.
How do you put that on your resume?
I was the first woman in space.
I can't imagine what that's. They're going to be well trained, and I know that whoever gets chosen will be do a fantastic job.
Well, I'm just proud to say I've wised up because in my household I don't run anything. My wife's the boss. So
I've been married 3 times, so I know the power of a woman.
So I have learned many years ago that you guys are much smarter than men. So no problem.
We have it together. It's good.
Okay, it's 3 things you need to know is brought to you by Beachside Hotel and Suites. Where you're always only steps away from the sand and only minutes from Port Canaveral. Check them out at beachsidehotelcocobeach.com. John, why don't you tell our listeners about the types of amenities that they can enjoy when they stay with Beachside Hotel and Suites.
When making your reservations, enjoy special packages such as Snooze and Cruise, Fly Snooze and Cruise, and military discounts. Beachside Hotel and Suites loves their military, so please make sure you take advantage of that. Once you arrive, enjoy a $6 million renovated property, complete with a heated lazy river so you can relax and enjoy your vacation. Duck Dive Bar and Grill, where you can enjoy coastal cocktails and delicious beach bites. And Lip Sync Karaoke on Friday nights from 6:30 to 9:30. And I say it every week. You're going to see me out there one of these nights doing the lip syncing. And Michelle actually was telling me earlier, if I'm not mistaken, there's going to be a magician tonight.
Yes, for President's Day weekend, we're having a magician tonight, along with the other things. So we just try and keep it all moving and keeping it interesting so everybody keeps coming back for our Friday night game.
And I think you're going to have a lot of people out there tonight only because you have a full house here.
Yes. Well, you know, President's Day weekend, when... Now that we're back to normal, represents the beginning of our season.
Wow,
so we're starting our season out full.
So there's always something going on at Beachside Hotel and Suites, live entertainment, magicians, karaoke bar. Just get here. This is where you want to stay. And before you go, check out their gift shop where you can purchase Cocoa Beach souvenirs from your stay. Make your reservations now at BeachsideHotelCocoaBeach.com. And during your stay, you just might see a rocket launch because the Space Coast is the only beach that doubles as a launch pad. Only here can you enjoy a relaxing beach day and watch a rocket launch. There is no substitute to experiencing the sights and sounds in person, so make your reservation today. So now it's time to find out three things that we need to know about today's guest, Ashley Nelsen, the lead of strategic communications at NASA. So, Ashley, take it away.
No pressure.
No pressure.
Being a local sports fan, I was previously an Orlando Magic dancer.
Get out of here.
Wow. Awesome. Great.
That's a neat thing to know.
I used to love going and watch the Magic play. Yeah. And that was the big days. That I don't know when you were a dancer for them.
2008 to 2013. So okay. I would say some good years. Made it to Definitely. The finals.
Oh, yes. Dwight Howard era.
Oh, yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
Big Dwight.
Dwight Howard era.
Good run back then. So
yeah.
It's fun.
Yeah.
He might have been one of those guys in the audience that was like literally, what's that word that you use when you're oogling a young lady?
Careful, my wife's watching, okay?
Yeah.
She's already warned him several times.
I don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah, be careful. There'll be ground up glass in your meatloaf.
Phil, you remember Anthony Hardaway?
Of course.
So everybody called
him. Penny Hardaway.
Yeah, but it was Anthony.
Yeah.
And somebody told me, I don't know if this is true, maybe they told me because his grandmother, that's how she was, Anthony, and it became Anthony Hardaway.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
That's a little trivia for
you. Yeah, you like that? A little trivia on today?
No, John, we're not buying that one.
That's what they told me.
No.
All right. Anyways,
okay,
that's
what
number
else?
One.
That's all right. Good.
Number two. So through that, I was a dancer and a gymnast. I've torn my ACLs 3 times dance and gymnastics.
Oh, my gosh.
Trampoline dunking. With the magic.
Wow. Get out of here.
Wow.
That would be fun.
Wait a minute. What is trampoline dunking?
She does the running, bounce.
So for white guys like me that can't jump, you do the trampoline, you jump and dunk. I want to try it.
It's okay. I'm black for nothing in basketball. So.
You good, man? My brother over here. I love it.
So go into a pool? Is that you jump?
No, on court. This was during the games.
Yeah.
As part of a halftime show.
The trampoline and dunk.
I would love to try that, man.
Dunk the ball.
I bet you Bonnie could do it.
And you could do like flips and stuff, right?
Yeah, and the most fun part is, you know, we're the dancers, we come out, we got our pom-poms, and then we put the pom-poms down and we start dunking, and it is the most, I loved being a dancer, but it was just like so fun to see people's reactions, to see a bunch of,
I mean,
I'm 5 feet tall, you know, I'm not what you would expect to dunk a basketball, so it was so fun to go and like kind of break down that
did you hang
on
the rim and do the whole swinging thing and all that?
Yeah, you know, you had to get aggressive.
I like it.
Were you able to dunk with one hand or did you have to dunk with two hands?
Did the Jordan?
Oh, you had to get a little fancy and.
Bam! Oh, wow. Cool. Oh, I would love to have seen that.
Yeah.
You got any videos of that?
I'm sure she does.
Yeah, I'm sure they exist.
We should set up a trampoline here next time we're here with a little dunk and we'll have a contest into the duck dive pool.
Wow, the first two things are great. What's the third one?
Not into the pool. Not into the pool.
So in addition to NASA and Artemis, my other passion is still dance. So I still coach today a competitive dance team here locally called Keegan Performance. So I can still stay involved. And
awesome.
Even though my knees are making me retire, I can still, you know, pass that on and put my energy into our younger dancers.
Izzy Gallery.
Wow. Great. I love that.
So Michelle
thank you for sharing.
Michelle mentioned that she has the lip sync karaoke. What's the one song that you choose?
Ooh.
I am a really nice person. I don't sing.
No.
What about
you, Ashley?
Man.
What's the genre of music?
Well, I would say depends on how many drinks.
That's it.
I feel like now, Journey just came to mind.
My wife used to be a karaoke DJ, and she's got a heck of a voice. She can sing real good. Oh. And Journey is her jam.
Nice.
Right.
So, like, Don't Stop Believing.
Yeah.
You know,
yeah.
That's a good one.
It's a classic.
That's a good one.
I mean, so that's always a great song at karaoke.
Yes,
which is your great song that you like to sing?
So I'll usually start with Garth Brooks' Friends in Low Places because it gets the drinkers engaged.
Right. Okay.
And then the second one that I'll do, I'll usually do Baby Got Back. We'll twist them up, right? And then if I'm in like a country meet, I'll do Devil Went Down to Georgia. I could throw that one pretty
good. Oh, my gosh.
I like it like a cadence.
That's it.
For the flow of the night.
Oh, I'm a performer all the way, so I'm like, I know the way the crowd's going. I'm like, all right, this will be fun.
My new favorite is My Humps from Fergie.
My Humps.
That's my new one. Man.
Your Lovely Lady Lumps. We're going to have a karaoke off one night. Okay?
Absolutely. I'm down.
All right, we'll do it.
Friday night, here's family night, so you bring the family.
We're going to stream it on the podcast.
Okay.
All right. Okay. Let's get back to what we're talking about. And let's talk about some of the partners that you are working with, that NASA works with in the future and whatever. So who are some of those partners?
So like I mentioned, this is America's rocket, you know, suppliers, over 3,000 suppliers from across the nation. For Artemis I, we have five primes. A lot of the companies most people around here are familiar with. We have Jacobs Technology is our ground systems prime contractor. Boeing is the core stage, the big yellow-orange tank.
Gotcha, right.
The solid rocket boosters or Northrop Grumman, right. Similar to what you'd see from Shuttle, except we have five solids. Shuttle only had four.
Wow.
Yeah.
All right.
Yeah.
Checkmate.
I'm visualizing now.
Rocket. So, and then we have Aerojet Rocketdyne for the RS-25 engines. Another comparison to Shuttle. Shuttle had three. We have four. And then Lockheed Martin is the Orion spacecraft. So that's Artemis I. The Artemis program, you know, it's more than just going to the moon. We want to establish that long-term presence for humanity and have people living and working on the moon. So future Artemis missions, we have the Gateway program, which will be, if you haven't heard about it, it kind of was mentioned in the videos, really, really neat. Kind of like a space station rotating around the moon so that astronauts can be there, and then from there they will dock from Orion, will go down to the surface of the moon through the human landing system. And so that was recently awarded to SpaceX. So that's how astronauts will get to and from the Gateway.
Wow.
See?
Until we get teleportation.
I know. There's so much going on. There's so much going on. Now, do you have anything to do at all with, like, SpaceX, Blue Origin, or any of those? Do you guys... cross paths somewhere?
Yes. I mean, Kennedy Space Center, there is a host of not only NASA programs, but commercial companies out there. So we work closely with them. We integrate a lot of them, you know, are working under NASA contracts, like our commercial crew program, where SpaceX is launching our crew to the space station. So we do work very closely with them and partner with them.
I just can't even begin to imagine how much crossway there is between all of you. And if people come here and visit the Kennedy Space Center and you go down as you're getting close to Kennedy Space Center and see the Blue Origin and see where SpaceX is, it's just amazing. We are that place. We are the place to visit for all of that.
Yeah. So much space going around here.
Very think tanky.
Yes.
Very smart people.
And a quick plug, when you do come here and you go to Kennedy Space Center Visitor Complex, make sure you use the coupon in the Space Coast Fun Guide. We can save $2.50 per adult on there, up to, I think, like $15, I think was the number. So, yeah, actually, Kennedy is awesome. And we talked about before, the food there is incredible. So if the missions that you do aren't enough, the food is awesome.
Okay. I walked on you finally. And now your favorite part of our podcast, the Space Coast Fun Guide's Deal of the Week, where we always give you the most fun coupons in the Space Coast. Space Coast Fun Guide Deal of the Week is brought to you by the Space Coast Fun Guide and spacecoastfunguide.com, where you'll learn what there is to see and do and where to do it. John, what is our exciting deal of the week today?
The exciting deal of the week.
Hey,
is Antiques Unique's Vintage Market in Melbourne. If you're an avid collector or a treasure seeker, guys, you have to go check out Antiques and Unique's Vintage Market. Learn more at antiquesanduniquesvintage.com. They have a 30, Bonnie, I know you're going to love this. They have a 32,000 square foot space with thousands of unique treasures. Create your personal style with eclectic finds. They have rare coins, NFL memorabilia. You hear that, Phil?
Yes.
NFL memorabilia, Hawaiian shirts, vintage tools, all kinds of things there. And you know what? There's no coupon today because the whole selection of items at Antiques and Uniques can be purchased at a great deal. So you definitely want to go check that out. And before you arrive in the Space Coast, log on to spacecoastfunguide.com and learn more about Antiques and Uniques Vintage Market right off our website, or once you arrive to the Space Coast, pick up a Space Coast Fun Guide at almost every major accommodation or attraction and read about Antiques and Uniques Vintage Market right in our printed visitor guide.
And I will say, because I go there, I know that place intimately, but they have a lot of space memorabilia there that people are selling that they've had in their home or whatever and have it there. So, and it's a great place for gifts. So when you're looking... You don't know. You may find some space stuff that you didn't even know was for sale. So.
And remember, when you're looking for fun in the Space Coast, make sure to refer to Space Coast Fun Guide for what to do and where to do it.
Absolutely.
John, did you say 32,000 square feet?
32,000. It's a big space, right?
Yeah. Oh my gosh.
I know. I'm
a big place.
For you know, my wife likes to go antiquing. That's something that we do you know, sporadically, I guess you'd say.
Me too.
It's spread out and there's tons of selection of stuff.
Me too.
Go check them out.
Ashley, we want to thank you so much for being with us today and educating us about what the Artemis program is. And as I said, I just want everybody to go to her website so that you guys can see how wonderful, wonderful job you guys are doing and how exciting for all of us to be part of it. And that's why when you come here on the Space Coast, it's a wonderful opportunity for you to see and do. You wanted to say something.
Yeah, I want to ask. We had so many questions and you had so many answers. Is there anything in particular that maybe that you wanted to share with us that we didn't get into?
No, I mean, we're just excited. We hope everyone is, you know, ready for this launch and is keeping an eye on the progress. We're going to continue to post updates. We post them on social media, the Artemis blog. So stay tuned to hear when we'll announce a launch date after this wet dress rehearsal that's coming up. So that's when things will really start to solidify.
You know what? We would love to have you back.
Yeah,
and announce the launch date on this podcast.
Great. I would love that.
Okay, $40.
$40. He's still pushing.
$99. Hey, for those of you that want to know, we have a lot of events going on this weekend, but two of the ones that I want to mention, the Strawberry Festival is going on at Wickham Park tomorrow.
Oh.
So that everybody loves the Strawberry Festival. If you love strawberries, you want to go to the Strawberry Festival. And another thing is the Green Gables Historic Home. I don't know if y'all are aware of that Green Gables Historic Home, but it's open on Saturdays from 10 to 2, and it's right there on the river, and it's preserved on riverfront property that utilizes and saves green space. And so we want to help out Green Gables because if they don't come up with the money to actually buy the building in July, it will be sold to a development. And we don't want to see that. So if you have the chance and you want to see a great historic home and see how it's decorated and get some history, it's a great place to go visit in Melbourne.
Did you talk about the mint?
No, you were going to talk about the mint. I was going to say, hey, speaking of the Super Bowl, Wayne.
Yes. I was so excited to find out, and I don't know if anyone else besides you and I at the table knows this, but the coin that they flip at the Super Bowl the last 28 years has been made right here in the Space Coast.
Say what?
In Melbourne.
Yeah, you can believe that?
Melbourne. Yeah, maybe we ought to go there and be on location there at some point and see how they do it.
Yeah, they can make a coin with 3-2-1 liftoff on it.
It's a nice shop. Yeah. It's a great location for you guys. Maybe that would be something for us to go see. That would be great. What do you think?
Yeah.
Right. It's right there on Riverside Drive in Melbourne.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
The man's name is Vincent Bobot. He's the executive vice president of this company, Highland Mint. And, wow, it's really exciting to me.
It is exciting.
There's so much here at the Space Coast. I mean, this is why people come to visit and end up living here.
Right.
Correct. I mean, honestly.
If you're planning your time to come here, just, you know, you can always go to visitspacecoast.com and you can look at the events that are coming up if you want to plan your vacation around an event that's happening here. And you'll want to be here when we have the liftoff of Artemis, which will be so much fun. So next week we are going to be at the annual, we're going to discuss the annual India Fest that comes to Wickham Park in Melbourne. It'll be March 5th and 6th is when they come, but we're going to meet the event organizers of it. And it's great with cultural shows, traditional Indian cuisines and fashion shows and music and arts and crafts. It's a great family event for sharing the Indian culture. So if you're looking for something to do, you want to check that out. And that'll be next week when we're here. So thank you all for coming. Thank you, Ashley. What a great time we've had. Thank you for educating us, and we will see you all next week.
Dance off, Ashley.
That's a wrap.
Bye.
We go.
Dance off.